Welcome
yeah,
to Spirit Studio Town Hall. I am Bishan Kumar.
And I'm Shalini Kumar, your co-host today.
So we have seen the long queues before liquor vends when different state government opened, allowed sale of liquor from retail. And we saw the people in the long queues. They're being lathi-charged. This was a pathetic sight. Also, quite a law and order issue for the different state governments, because when social distancing was a norm, there was no social distancing at the events. The courts had to intervene. The High Court and Supreme Court especially asked state governments to look into the option of home delivery or online delivery of liquor products. Some states went ahead and did something about it, but still I feel the half-baked attempts. It's a long way to go. And today we are going to examine this issue from different stakeholders.
And today we have very powerful panelists with us to discuss about this very, very important issue. We have Mr. Deepak Roy with us, who is an industry veteran and is executive vice chairman of ABT. And now in an advisory role. Welcome, Mr. Roy.
Thank you.
And then we have Prasanna Natarajan, founder of HipBar, a technology app for delivering the online delivery of alcobev products. And then obviously we have with us Nishant Srivastava, who is the founder and partner of Actus Legal Firm in Delhi. And we have then Divya Balivada. She is director of Cheers Group. And let's welcome you all in Town Hall, Spirits Studio.
So I couldn't see Prasanna. Is he around?
Yeah, yes, she is there. Prasanna, your...
Yeah.
Prasanna, yes, raise your hand. Prasanna, raise your hand. Yeah.
Yes.
Can you see, Mr. Ross?
I'm sorry. No. I can't, but doesn't matter. I'm sure. Now I can see.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, now you can see. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Okay.
I'll first go to Mr. Deepak Roy. With his kind of experience in industry, he has seen various troubled times and good times in industry. Now, this is the time which nobody in human history has seen. Mr. Roy, what do you think that the state government should do? And what? How can industry help that state governments to formalize a strategy to go for the online home delivery of liquor products?
Okay, Vishen, thank you for your question. As chairman of CIABC and also as somebody who's been in the industry a long time, we have been lobbying with state governments for a very, very long time to allow some kind of an online delivery system, failing which a plain delivery system or a click and collect system, because social distancing seems to be a big challenge right now. And what we saw in the first few days of the opening of liquor outlets in Delhi was scary.
Yeah.
It was much worse than what anybody expected.
True.
And actually, I think most state governments should have anticipated this, because they were opening the outlets after more than 2.5 months. And there was a lot of pent-up demand. And the moment they announced, first of all, they opened only 20% of the corporation outlets only, which is against... approximately 700 or 800 outlets in the Delhi market. So they only opened about 30, 40 outlets spread across the city of Delhi. And it was very sad to see the kind of crowds that collected to buy liquor. But I think given that it was not being available for 70 days and some people really need their requirements of liquor on an everyday basis, and one should have anticipated this. It was sad what happened. We had been representing to the Delhi state government that, guys, think of a home delivery system, or in the event you can't do that, then think of a click and collect system so that people can place their order online and then come and collect it
That would have been better.
At a particular fixed time, you know, they issue a token and they come and collect it. There's no social crowding. I think the state government took a long while to respond to this, though now I believe they are very, very much committed to the idea of implementing it. But as yet, they've only opened 30% of all the outlets. So I don't know when they will really start doing this. In the meantime, two states, Chhattisgarh and Punjab, took a lead. Surprisingly, Chhattisgarh of all the states, which has never been prominent or leading the liquor industry in any which way, but they decided on an online system. Punjab started the click and collect system. And then, of course, West Bengal had started about a month back, but then they were asked to shut it down because the central government said no liquor. So these three states have implemented it in the right spirit and seems to be working out. Not heard of many complaints. Maharashtra, a week back, introduced a delivery system in all markets except Bombay and Pune. I believe in the last one week alone, 300,000 deliveries were made in the Thane district.
Okay.
So the consumers are ready for it, but the state governments are still not ready from the mindset point of view, because their concerns are, how do we know that the person ordering online is 21 years old or 25 years old or 21, as the age case may be. Second, how will we protect our revenue? People from, you know, it's not just the people from within state, people from, they can, if it is an online system, you could get it from anywhere in the country and we will lose our revenue. There are simple solutions, digital solutions to all this, but the state governments don't easily start understanding this, and you know, the babus will lose some of their control. But I think given the need of the hour and the COVID menace, so even though it's not for good reasons, but I think now more and more states are beginning to examine this proposition. And I think you will eventually start seeing online delivery or telephone delivery system being introduced in some form or the other in every state.
So I'd like to go to Divya now. Because
let's welcome our two esteemed guests have joined in now. Let's welcome them. Dr. G.V. Rao, he is a very senior advocate of Supreme Court of India. Welcome to our show, Dr. G.V. Rao. And then we have Mr. V. Ramesh Mani, who is also an industry veteran. And he's giving us today the perspective of what other countries are doing in this regard. So welcome, Mr. Mani, on the show.
Mr. Mani is currently in Sydney, Australia.
Yeah.
Because he travels, settles between India and Australia. So what Mr. Roy has said so far, I'll take it to Divya. Divya, because you also are one of the manufacturer of alcoholic beverages. And you have seen that there is a definite demand to go for online delivery. What do you think, what could be the step? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that this is the way to go about. And also to ensure that transparency and that the revenue is not lost. So excise has no issues about it. Your audio is not. We can't hear you.
I can hear you.
Okay.
Hello.
We
can't hear you.
Yeah, we can't hear you, Divya.
You seem to have gone off.
So I think...
Hello.
Yeah, let's...
Mr. Mani can answer this. Mr. Mani, you have handled different liquor industries in India, liquor companies, also seen what is happening the world over.
Yeah.
Slightly louder, Mr. Mani. We can't hear you.
Audible.
No, it's not.
Audible,
but very, very feeble voice. Please.
Okay.
Come closer to your mic.
Is it clear now?
Yeah, yeah. It's better now. It's better now.
More specifically to Australia and New Zealand, these are the two markets that I have actually been spending time.
I can't hear you at all, Ramesh.
You use your headphone and come to speak on this.
Yeah, closure. Use your headphone, Mr. Mani. Divya, are you using your headphone?
Divya, your audio is logged.
Audio is logged.
Open the audio icon, red icon.
You have to unmute it.
But it's still not audible.
You're not audible. You use your headphone, please.
Divya,
Yes, Mr. Mani.
Much better. Divya, use your...
Yes, better.
Yes, yes. Yes, yes, very good.
Can you hear me now, Mr. Roy?
Yeah.
Mr. Roy, he's asking.
But you're breaking a bit.
I can tell you a little about what has been happening here in Australia and New Zealand. But this is again a market where online started not too long ago. So just about 2017, they started the online business. And I'm quite surprised that we are taking such a long time and that's anything over online business. When it's not a substitute for any of the sales, it's not a substitute for wholesale, it's not a substitute for retail, except the vehicle. It's just a vehicle. It's a different state team of, meeting the product, the customer. The online business in 2017 has been growing at the rate of 17%, and they need it to grow about 25-30%, and currently is $600 million.
And the guy's audio is very, very poor. I can barely hear what somebody is saying.
Mr. Mani, do not use your Bluetooth, please. I think you are using Bluetooth. Use your headphone, wired headphone, connected to your laptop or iPad. So that would be more, audio would be a bit clear.
This kind
of sometimes I have to look for my
iPhone.
Okay. Can we go back to Divya?
Yeah, Divya. You are better now.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes. Yeah, Divya. Yes.
Yeah, you.
Sorry. Could you please repeat the question for me? Because I lost connection midway.
Yeah. See, if you heard Mr. Roy's suggestion, what the government, he said, is way ahead now, that this every state government has to take measures to implement some kind of, either the your book and collect or the home delivery or both can coexist together. So what do you think, what should be the measures the state government should take in and how industry can help to formulate a strategy to go for the home delivery and online sale of liquor?
To be honest, I'm really happy about this news that home delivery is an available option for beverage alcohol products, especially for women, because we generally shy away from going to the liquor stores and all. And now we can sit at home with ease and order what we like. And there'll be more options to look at other brands and carefully shop what we want to get. So in this way, I would say that the state government could come up with something in order to partner with these delivery platforms. So the licensed liquor stores could partner with these delivery platforms and deliver it, like it would be B2C delivery option. I think that would be a very good move to go about. This way, I think it would create more options and more awareness to many people. And just as how the food industry picked up after these delivery platforms came into the market, similarly, the beverage alcohol industry will also have its, an entire new segment that's going to come up. And it's going to lift up the market altogether. And as far as addressing the legal drinking age is concerned, I think as far as addressing that, I would say that that wouldn't be much of a problem, because anyways, these people, when they order, all we have to do is show an ID card. And anyways, under 18 or under 25 or below the legal drinking age, people do not cannot really order at home because, you know, like they cannot really validate the fact that they're above 25 unless they show a valid ID. So I guess on delivery, your valid ID card should be shown and then we can execute the transaction. I guess that way it should be a problem. It shouldn't be a problem. And as far as evasion of taxes, I don't see a way how there could be any issues about, not following the protocol. Because as far the state regulates these duties and carefully monitors the licenses the stores hold. So it just goes from these licensed stores directly to the consumers with the help of these delivery platforms. I think it's pretty much clear and there shouldn't be a problem to launch this online shopping of beverage products in the country.
Okay. So now I come to Dr. G.V. Rao. Can you tell us, Mr. Dr. Rao, that what needs to be changed in the existing excise laws and its pros and cons?
See, the excise law from the times when we've had it in as it was framed, levies excise on the product when it leaves the warehouse. So it is specifically stated that, you know, the levy of excise will come when it rolls out of the factory or leaves the warehouse of where it is being manufactured. And also when it comes to giving it to a distributor for sales, again, the points are determined in terms of exigibility. Now, what happens perhaps with there, that is their fear that once it goes directly to the consumer and it avoids, say, a retailer or a wholesaler, the point of levy of duty may get blurred. It can, if you because there's no mechanism, which we can today, we have in the architecture to have mechanism of actually tracing where every single bottle, for instance, is being sold. Yeah, you know, if you use technology. So it's a misnomer, but the law does not have those aspects incorporated in exercise on exigibility of various taxes, etc. So as discussing the other day, there is also the whole parallel alcohol sales industry, which comes through various sources of being brought into the country through the through shipping channels or across the borders or etc. So there are issues regarding that, which the government perhaps, because it is one of the largest revenue earner for state government, for central government, etc. So because the mindset of a bureaucracy is not to take too much responsibility where things can go wrong, and B, ensure and not be blamed or be made responsible for the leakage of revenue because of the other sales as well. So it is, first, there has to be political will to do anything. Once the government decides that the online sales and home delivery of alcohol is a pretty much a requirement of the day, it is the requirement of the current scenarios and circumstances, and it is also something which needs to be attended to seriously. Because I think government has already realized that during pandemic, during lockdown times, one of the things that may get them the revenue and the is alcohol, because people are used to consuming. The government always realized the fact that there is a very important aspect that alcohol consumption and alcohol sales are a great source of revenue. But what happens is other areas of industry are not generating the kind of revenue that would require to be quick earning revenue. So this they have realized. I guess there will be a sensible thinking in the matter by the government in order to amend the excise laws and other perhaps legal age of drinking issues, and also how to use technology for sales. For instance, you know, we have to be a lot more, cautious. If the person who is ordering, like for instance, when some of you who are familiar with Amazon and Big Basket, etc., where you do online shopping, online purchases, so the person has to be identified. You can have an Aadhaar card or whatever it is. The number of bottles that are being delivered will be thing for government to trace it, and you know from where it is originating and where it is being delivered. All of these new parameters and factors can be brought into the picture in order to make it a responsible sale. The idea is that A, revenue is not lost. B, it is a responsible sale where it doesn't result in underage persons. Also, there is a bigger, very big problem which was identified by WHO as well as the UN Secretary General. That some of this liquor consumption during pandemic and lockdown times is causing domestic violence. The women are, suffering, and it is found by studies that alcohol consumption leads to a kind of, a behavior which is not exactly responsible. So there has to be a caution on that also. And if you see worldwide, there has been complaints that alcohol consumption during pandemic, because there is not much work to do, there may be frustration, men are not exactly responsible, they may misbehave in the house, having responsibilities, other things. This is a study, and I've looked into it very carefully, that is another aspect which government would like to regulate.
According to you, there should be a cautious approach, balancing the...
Yes, absolutely. You see, it is actually, if you see, not only times immemorial, it is even currently the conservative thinking is that it is a social evil. Alcohol is a social evil in many... You know, the other point is, very importantly, we must look at the section or the class of society from whom which this could cause a lot more difficulty. Because
we'll come to that clause again. About the classification of liquor. Right. See, I slightly disagree with your contention that liquor leads to domestic violence. It's not necessarily liquor leads to that. Domestic violence per se is an issue which is not necessarily linked with consumption of liquor, number one. Number two, during this lockdown period, majority of the household didn't have any kind of liquor available to them. And all the violence that happened, domestic violence happened, not necessarily to liquor consumption. Fair. We come later on with that. Maybe we can move on to Nishan.
Your audio is not...
Nishan, you can switch on your audio.
I had unmuted it. Now it's on.
Sorry. So now we come to you, Nishan. As you as you heard that Mr. Roy and Dr. Rao both have said that there should be a cautious approach, but this at the time of social distancing, this is the best approach to deliver the alcohol products, home delivery or online. So it's the best approach.
Shalini, before we move on,
yeah,
I would like to respond to a few things that Dr. Rao has said.
Please.
I first of all, he's brought out this issue about the irresponsible use of alcohol and also the issue about domestic violence. First of all, I don't think today's discussion is about the goods and bads of alcohol. That is a subject that has been debated for the last 70 years since our independence, and it has been almost an established thing that alcohol drinking, responsible alcohol drinking, should be allowed. So the subject is not the whether the alcohol is good or bad. I mean, I can argue for 200 days, 200 hours about saying that there's nothing wrong in drinking alcohol. So I don't want to get into that debate at all. The question, as you rightly said, is to see whether is there an alternate method to deliver alcohol to the consumer.
Correct. Correct.
He is going to drink either way. Let me tell you that even during the lockdown period in most states, there was adequate alcohol illegally or illicit alcohol was available. And the whole thing is to avoid, illicit liquor and as well as avoid taking away government's revenues through smuggling and whatever else that was happening. Right. So I don't want to get into that debate with Mr. Rao and anyone else. Alcohol has a very important role to play in today's society. It's a great social lubricant. People must be educated as to how to imbibe alcohol responsibly. And just by depriving them one method of delivery, that is not going to change add to the fears that people have about alcohol.
Yeah.
So let's stick to the topic, which is whether home delivery is possible and what are the fears the state governments have.
Yeah, you rightly said, Mr. Roy, as this is not the topic today to discuss about the domestic violence or drinking. This is about the home delivery of liquor at this time of social distancing. This makes sense now. So Nishant,
can I quickly respond or you want me to do it
later. Otherwise, the entire discussion will be derailed.
Nishant, over to you now.
Yeah. Good afternoon, all. I just don't want to sound a spoiler sport, but there are certain things in the recent scheme of home delivery, which has been adopted by some of the states. Where, before commenting on the future prospect of this particular scheme or model of home delivery, I would just point out certain things. One, very importantly, this is a very, very temporary aspect. It's a very temporary thing which is there. If you see what Supreme Court has said or the state governments, why they have decided or allowed home delivery, we would find that the basic rationale behind it is to avoid overcrowding at places. Possibility of community spread of coronavirus. And that is the fundamental and only factor behind the governments allowing the supply at home. Secondly, then if you see the what had happened because of the lockdown, the governments have found their sources of revenue completely dried up. So they realize that this is one area, this is one commodity where they can get maximum revenue at the same, very easily. They can fetch maximum revenue. That's why they allowed sale of liquor and even allowed home delivery of liquor. Now the things like 70% corona fee over and above the MRP, is just clearly shows what the government wants out of this industry in these particular times. It's nothing like long-term planning which the government is coming up. Definitely not. Had it been there, the government's perspective was to involve private players like, home delivery aggregators kind of thing. They would have involved Swiggy and Zomato and all these things, but they have just allowed their own corporations, excise department, their own corporation. Delivery is only through them, and that too from a retailer shop to the consumer's place. That too with so many restrictions. You have what rightly pointed out, the age thing is there, the quantity is there. There are so many restrictions involved with that. Now, another very interesting aspect, what I realized, I was trying to find out how many states have allowed the home delivery these days. You would see a very interesting chasm. You will find that only the non-BJP ruled states have allowed home delivery. Only the non-BJP ruled states. And there is complete mum from most of the states which are ruled by one particular party, that is BJP. Then again, when we are talking about home delivery, we are basically talking about home delivery to people, consumers there in the metropolitan cities. We are not talking about India. We are talking about Mumbai. We are talking about Delhi, Goa, and all these places. We are not talking about India. So there is a clear lack of thinking about a bigger perspective. It's like a stopgap arrangement where the government wants to extract maximum revenue out of some particular industry, so they are allowing this very thing. So that was my preliminary observation with respect to the future of this home delivery thing.
Right.
in the meeting. So I'll now like to go to the technology brain among us, Prasanna Natarajan. Prasanna, have you heard the two sides of views so far? That the manufacturers say that yes, the retail and online delivery can coexist. The legal experts say that their excise the mindset has to change, and they have to look at the pictures holistically. So you had launched your app in Karnataka. Do you think now there will be kind of a race for to have such aggregating app which could be facilitating the delivery of liquor online, and that will help people like you to find your space which you have lost due to certain legal issues? Your audio.
So there are multiple issues involved in this. Obviously, the one aspect is the legal aspect, which is the, you know, elephant in the room. We have to address that. So Hibbar's, way of looking at this entire home delivery business is, we have an association with this idea much before COVID came. So we looked at, opening home delivery despite the circumstances that have emerged recently. So as somebody who's had such a long association with this idea, I can say that home delivery of alcohol, which is technology assisted, can address all concerns, right from the ones of quantity, whatever you cannot enforce in the real world, you will be able to enforce it better on the, when it comes to a tech assisted home delivery service. Our whole, thought process when I started Hibbar in 2015, is that legally there is no challenge in starting a home delivery service, because the legal basis of making the statement is that a customer has a right to appoint an agent to perform certain activities on his behalf. So if so long as the principal and the agent are over the legal drinking age and able to enter into a contract, so this contract is valid. So the question is, instead of me going to the shop and buying alcohol, can I nominate somebody else to go and pick it up on my behalf? So this is the key question that should be asked in the legal forums. So the second aspect of this argument is that there is no intelligible differentia between a retailer servicing a customer or an agent of the customer. So there cannot be a law which there cannot distinguish between a customer and an agent to be applied universally for saying that there cannot be any delivery mechanism. Or so our business was to actually have a system of collection agents who will go and act on behalf of the customers to go and buy alcohol on their behalf. So the entire facility of making the payment also we facilitated through a mobile wallet where the customer would pay the outlet directly, and as an intermediary we don't touch the money. So imagine a situation where a customer picks a product from a catalog of drinks available around him. And he has, if for people who are wealthy, they could send their drivers or their house errand boys to go and buy liquor. But we wanted to democratize that in a responsible manner. So the questions are, how do you control consumption at an individual level? So it is not like, it's a free for all where everybody can order liquor indiscriminately. So we suggested to the government to come up with, best practices to restrict the number of times a person can order, restrict the quantity a person can order, place from where they can order from. For example, if you're sitting in Kabban Park in Bangalore, that area will be blacked out and you will not be able to order from that public place. So we identified zones which are public zones and eradicated people from or potentially ordering from that. Similarly, there was transparency on pricing, availability. There was, we were brand agnostic. All the brands that were available in the market, which retailers wanted to put up as stock, we facilitated that. So my overall point is that legally there is still, we always get under the clock of Article 47, which says India should move towards prohibition. Therefore, any law that should be favored in view should gravitate towards prohibition or prohibiting. So we said that that is not the right way. In fact, the tech-assisted delivery model is much more closely aligned to Article 47 goals, because you can control and you can bring about change. Whereas in the real world, nobody asks the question to a customer as to whether he goes and drinks it by himself, whether he goes and gives it to his underage nephew. But whereas these questions are all asked of an online system. So, which is fair, because the online system lends itself to being transparent all the time. So long as there are responsible operators who look at the impact of their service that is going to cost to the community and do it in a responsible manner, I think the time has come for this idea. Despite, if the world didn't see a COVID, Hibbar would have still continued its, journey towards opening up home delivery.
Okay, so you mean to say that home delivery is the best option if well assisted through technology? It can be
better monitored, better administered, and absolutely there cannot be any iota of bias or partiality. The existing state structures can be preserved.
I ask a question to you, Mr. Mani, that we have discussed about the possibility of home delivery, and what could be the feasibility, transparency issues, the pricing factors, the legalities of it. Now give us our audience a perspective, because you are in Australia currently. How you people or your friends buy liquor there, and how easy it is, and what kind of laws?
It's very simple.
Laws it permit there? Yeah.
You see, there are plenty of laws. Australia is like India; it's a federation of states, and liquor is a state subject. Queensland has very different laws. When you compare it to Victoria, and Victoria has different laws vis-a-vis New South Wales. So the laws are very different, but by and large, the broad framework is set by the federation, which is the federal government. The drinking age is 18 years and above, and they're very strict about it. You need an ID to buy liquor or consume liquor. Okay, the laws are several, but the three main laws are BYO law, law where restaurants need a BYO license if they don't want to sell liquor but allow the guests to come and drink. The other one is a general license, which is an on-trade license for clubs, bars, pubs. And then there is a license which is a productive license, a packaged liquor productive license, which is for retailers and wholesalers. Now, online business is very simple here, and getting a license, online license for online delivery takes not less than 7 to 10 days. They will say 30 days, but you get the license in 7 days. So what are the laws relating to online delivery? One, you have got to buy, you are only a delivery vehicle. You're just a delivery vehicle. You know, it's not a substitute for a wholesaler or a retailer. You have to buy from a retailer, whether it's Dan Murphy or BWS or Liquorland or any of these biggies. Buy from them and you can deliver. And when you deliver, one, the boy who delivers, boy or girl who delivers, has to have a RSA, which is Responsible Service of Alcohol. So the government in turn has courses called RSA, and most of the delivery boys and girls have to go through that course, which sets what are the rules. So when they deliver, they have to check the ID, ask for the ID, check the ID, see whether the person is in a state of, you know, soberness. Sobriety is very important, not intoxicated. And then record his age and details, his or her age details, and then find everything is online. So there is a lot more transparency in a tech-driven world. I think, I don't know why we are debating on transparency when online and digitization is the most transparent form. What you can't do elsewhere, you can do it there. And loss of revenue, I don't think there could be much of any loss of revenue, you know, right, when it's so transparent, the system. Australia, New Zealand and several other countries have even gone to the extent of online delivery of cocktails from on-premise. Mm-hmm. You know, you can order any cocktail from any of your restaurant, and that is delivered along with your food.
So in the online delivery model, how the social distancing protocols are being complied with? What are the standard principles that people have to go through certain trainings and how they deliver actually? They press your bell or do not press your bell?
No, they're contactless. You just call.
Yeah.
Call your customer. And the customer, in case if there is alcohol, the customer has to show at least his or her face.
Okay.
You know, in case of food, it can be left out. But this can't be left unattended. The customer has to. Mm. And the customer has to at least show the ID.
Right.
These are there. And it's a very simple process. And the online business has been growing. It was not long back introduced. It was only in 2017 that Australia brought about the online delivery of liquor. Mm-hmm. And since then, it has been growing. Today, it's around $600 million. Okay, Australia has a very large liquor market. It's over 14 billion. In a 14 billion market, it's about 600 million, growing at the rate of 17% and expected to grow between 25 to 30% over the next 2-3 years.
So what would be the
pandemic or a crisis to get into digitization or to get into online business. Yeah, you know, you have all the systems in place. Today you have the Aadhaar card, you have so many other identification. Where is the problem? It's mindset. It's basically, the fear that fine all liquor guys will mess around, and that's the fear. It's very simple system. I don't see any issues anywhere, not only here, in a number of countries across.
Sir, you are not in India. You're in Australia. You know the hypocrisy which prevails in India and what kind of mindset we have.
But despite the fact that you will be dry of all the reserves and funds without liquor. And responsible drinking is important.
Yeah.
You know, that's what the government should emphasize on.
Yes.
Education is important. You know, the more you try to restrain and more you get into such kind of restrictions, I think the more people will, you see what happened, the queues and all the social distancing norms were violated when the liquor shops opened. So this could have been anticipated earlier. You don't need a pandemic. To drive technology, you don't need all this.
I totally agree with what Ramesh is saying.
Mm.
Social distancing norm don't come only in the purchase of liquor. You see what happened at the railway stations Bandra yesterday. You see what is going on in registration offices to register yourself as an Indian citizen that you want to travel. I mean, you have such ridiculous laws. There are going to be more violations of the social distancing norm. It is the mindset of our bureaucrats who can't think beyond their, whatever. I don't want to use such words. But the reality is that the bureaucracy and the politicians don't know how to rule and how to implement simple ideas. That's the
challenge. Actually very simple. That's true.
Yeah.
And so, this online is not... It's nothing so... You know, what is so special about online? It's ease of doing business. It's transparency. It's making things better. It's technology.
And look at our Sardarji, the chief minister in Punjab. He understood that all this nonsense will come up. All he said was, what am I doing? I'm saying you click online that I want to buy my liquor and I will issue a token electronically to you. And you go and pick up the liquor. So there's no really social distancing challenge.
Yeah, and his revenue is secured.
And you had to have a pragmatic mindset. Somebody mentioned about the 70% cess. I think the 70% cess was totally ill-advised. The chief minister got nervous when the first day there were riots at the liquor outlets without trying to analyze the reasons and without trying to understand why those things happened. If we have only 15 to 20% outlets open after 60 days, there is bound to be somewhat of crowding. This happens in the railway station. It happens in any other area where you have to. I remember in Bombay when we were having problem with getting essentials, there was serious challenges because people were trying to rush in and buy the rations.
Yeah, so true.
They must. We are a country of 1.3 billion. before we implement anything, we need to really think through how to bring about an orderly system. And bureaucrats don't want to apply their mind. They are only responding and reacting. They never think, they never preempt as to what could go right or what could go wrong. And listen, you know, the industry has offered all the help and services. We have the ability to get the best experts from every consulting company and say, here, these guys will help you implement. But it's like NIS, sorry, you guys don't know what you're talking about. This is article, whatever that in applies, and we cannot listen to you guys. So there is, fortunately, there are now some state governments who have started responding to this in a very sensible manner. Bengal, Chhattisgarh, Punjab, Delhi, and Maharashtra. Like these five or six states start, it's a matter of time the others will follow.
That's true. So I think it's just a matter of time.
I think this is going to evolve. It's a natural evolution process.
Correct.
And there is always a resistance to change in this country. As somebody from the person who developed a special short work in Karnataka, he mentioned every challenge about identifying age, identifying who's collecting, how is it being delivered, this can be tackled without any problem. It's more the mindset.
And is the liquor is genuine or not? That is also can be tracked.
Yeah, absolutely. You can do track and trace everything that you need to, because the consumer will get the right stuff.
Yeah.
Because Indians by nature are jugadu, will find a way to reach illicit liquor also. It's a sad part of this thing, but that will happen in any business.
Anywhere.
My question
so, to Roy, I just have a question. Can I jump in and ask the question?
Yeah, sure.
Please.
Yeah. So the real question to you is, how much of this forward-looking nature of our industry has not moved forward in the last so many years? How much has the industry itself to contribute to that factor? Because there are traditional, licensees, there are trade associations. How much have they scuttled development of our sector?
If you have seen a change, once again, can I just point out, if you have seen a change in the last 3 months, it is primarily because of the efforts of CIABC, which has been driving this agenda for the last 6 months. Let's have this. But in 3 months, the change, even during the COVID times, we have been actively,
engaging with the
following
government.
Up with every state government and trying to make them bring about this change.
Okay.
The industry, there have been some bad eggs in the industry who have followed wrong practices. There continue to be some people, but we in CIABC are very, very clear as to who can be part of an institution and who's not. So they have to meet a certain criteria. Everybody can't just pay 10 lakhs and say, okay, here I'm the member. We don't permit that. Everybody has to go through a strict scrutiny. So your point is valid that to some extent the industry is responsible for some of the wrong practices that continue. And even within the organized sector, it's because this will help my company more. We have that attitude. But people are not looking at the
larger picture.
Fact that this is going to help the industry long term. But I'm telling you, this is actually now the green shoots have already started appearing for home delivery, and unless somebody really messes up with it, I think it's here to stay.
My question to you, Mr. Roy, is that we have been talking to lots of retailers. They have a fear in their mind that...
Absolutely correct. That's a very correct fear. You see, that those are the things that are coming in the way right now. Because the wholesaler thinks that his business is going to be taken away. The retailer thinks that his business is going to be taken away. Now, therefore, this can also be sorted out by involving the retail associations, the wholesale association, and say, find a win-win solution that nobody loses.
Exactly. Everybody gains.
And that is, at least from as a chairman of CIABC, that's where my attempt is to involve and get everybody to participate in this whole new deal.
But
I have a question. Sorry. In this online business, where does the product go from? Does it not go
from the retail shop? No.
It's not sure. It can, like, for example, West Bengal is going to supply all the products from their corporation.
Yeah. But even
the retailer is therefore very concerned that he has paid for a license, he's getting the stocks, and all the consumers in his market have turned to online, and therefore I'm going to lose my revenue. But those are concerns, and every partner in this whole trade has to be, you know, their interest has to be looked at and find a solution for it. But this can only happen when it starts.
Yeah.
I have a question.
The government, our government believe that they are the only lawmakers. The bureaucrats believe that only they can make the law. They don't realize they can involve all the stakeholders. Bring them under one table and have a discussion.
True.
Yeah, Diva wants to ask some question. Yeah,
Diva. Go ahead.
I would like to ask something. The thing is, would it not be a win-win situation if this delivery started from the retailer and not from the wholesaler, so that it's a win-win situation for everybody, all stakeholders?
That's how it's happening. That's how predominantly government are designing it. Even Bengal mooted the idea of doing it from depots predominantly because they don't have good inventory management system at the retail store level. But I think, you know, it involves a little bit of change management. There is a need to, you know, have some kind of system to develop digital records at what is available at the stores so that the customer delivery, the service delivery can be done very well. Because if you order something and it's not available, then this is exception handling and it takes its own toll on the, you know, the logistics and the service. So
what's the point of... Prasanna and
just
Mr.
as
Roy,
from the grocery store,
and Divya, and other people. So my question is, it's kind of a continuation of what Divya asked, that what is the point of having a new modern app or technology when you are not going to do away with one layer of whole
system.
Yeah. Supply system? Why you need a retailer at all? Or you need to minimize the retail operators and the margin they pocket in is quite a hefty margin they pocket in.
That is a sure way of ensuring that no the online system will fail.
Don't forget that groceries
are delivered online. You can still go and buy a grocery. Yeah. You can't try to take away somebody else's business to start an online business.
Yeah.
So we have to get every partner involved. We can. The idea is not about eliminating anybody from the supply chain.
Yeah.
Okay.
They might to shell out.
No, I wanted to bring up, like the grocery stores.
Allow me to address you for a moment.
Yeah, Dr. Rao.
Yeah. Most of you gentlemen here perhaps have some kind of are a part of the industry and have to view it from a industry perspective for the fact to bring about it or make it happen, etc. From my point of view, I'm a completely new observer in this, and I'm not against it. I'm only telling you that the manner in which you have to view the whole issue of making it happen when you're dealing with government. Because the government has a certain perception of the things, which you may keep on loudly and in a shrill voice say that they don't know what they're doing and all that. But shrillness of your voice will not help you get what you want. You have to be sensible.
Mr. Rao, I have been dealing with government data for the last 40 years, and I've never... You are not understanding the point I'm making.
No, I did not interrupt you. I could have very well done that.
That every stakeholder, and that includes the government, that includes everyone, has to be. everything has
been in the process by this type of thing. You know, you may do that with government also tomorrow, but just a moment, listen to me.
They are a stakeholder in the business. They are a larger stakeholder. They make the most revenue.
I have patience to listen to somebody else. I did not interrupt you even for a moment. Now, please listen to me.
No, Dr. Rao, actually,
I have dealt with the government as a crawling baby. I know, I mean, perhaps we don't want to tell what we want to do, but I know government, perhaps you, as much as you don't know know about. Listen to me. I am giving you advice which basically means how the matter should be approached. The matter should be approached because government is not going to merely listen to a shrill argument. It may listen to a sensible argument.
Yeah, that's what my point to you, Dr. Rao.
Spoken with the concern of various aspects, 360 degree approach.
Yeah.
You merely may have looked at it from a point of view, brushing it aside. Oh, the domestic violence is nowhere in this picture. We are only talking about home delivery. No, government will not look at it like that.
No, right. Dr. Rao, my point to you is that domestic violence has been prior to this also.
Now, if you want to interrupt me and cut me off from what I'm saying, that's another matter.
I'm not. I'm only trying to say that nobody is saying that the government should not be consulted or the government should not be taken into account.
Okay, Mr. Roy, we have to have a different way of dealing with this. Please speak after I have spoken. Allow me to come.
Please understand, for 40 years I'm doing nothing then but dealing with the governments in our industry.
I've been doing from the day I finished my schooling and joined law school, and I've been dealing with government. From the
attorney, so am I. That's what I'm trying to tell you.
Were you in the Attorney General's office?
Yeah.
No, but the...
You were sitting in the Attorney General's office?
No, but the excitement...
I've seen Mr. Roy all the time trying to interrupt a particular point of view which I'm trying to protect across.
It
may not be that way, sir. Mr. Rao, you go ahead. You tell your perspective.
That's what I'm saying. That Mr. Roy will continue to interrupt me because I'm trying to tell you have to have a 360 degree approach.
Yeah, please finish your argument.
Government to give you a patient hearing, for government to resolve the issue. And for that, you have to look at all aspects of it. Now, let me tell you one thing. Let me give you a very small example. What you saw images on television. Was it gentlemen like you and me crowding at the alcohol shop? Was it people like you who could speak the language that we are speaking that were crowding at the alcohol shop?
Yeah, why don't you come to the point? You're still going on the same point.
Finish your point.
Dr. Rao, we all are stakeholders here.
Everybody is a stakeholder, and I have told you I have not a stakeholder.
Perfect.
I give you an independent point of view from my experience as to how government deals with it.
Absolutely perfect. Thank you very much.
And for that, you have to look at a 360 degree approach.
You got your point.
Sure, got your point.
Because those people who are not committing social distancing were not from the same strata of society as you and me. And 95 to 99% of alcohol consumption comes from there. And if you want to persuade government, they will tell you this. Those who are they failed to do social distancing are not you. They don't speak this language. They speak something else, and that's why they are doing it in the first place.
Okay.
And if they find irresponsible doing that, they when you order alcohol and supply it to them in their house, they will further be irresponsible in doing that.
Okay.
And that is my point.
Social distancing. I have a point on social distancing. I have a point on those large queues in India. I live in a country which is so-called developed and first world. I see no semblance of social distancing even amongst educated and affluent. So it's a state of mind, it's education, and it's a context. So it's not socio-economic. It's because India is a 1.35, vast majority, lower middle class, lower. So you get to see them. That's it. So social distancing is a state of mind. It's there across. If you want to defy it, you will defy it. That's one. Number two is, it's very important to talk about technology. Okay. Liquor, yes. liquor is a taboo in India. It's always been an issue. But you have to look at the way in which the world is heading. The way in which business is transacted. It's tech all over. So do we introduce technology and make it more transparent and make it more easy for the government to function and exercise control? That's right. That's more important. So without it, government will carry on this way and our life in society will carry on that way. So we have to change. We have to bring about some change. Yes, government also has to change. And as Mr. Roy said, it's evolution. And I'm pretty sure despite all the issues, gradually governments, state governments will fall in line. Exactly. And it may take a longer time, but it'll happen.
Yeah,
that's maybe yeah, I'm
that's
too
optimistic, surely happen.
Wildly optimistic, but yeah. That is the way it is going to be.
Right,
the world is changing. India's
okay,
changing.
I'm not here to pick up issues with Mr. Rao. He is a very, very learned Supreme Court lawyer, and I have the highest regard for Supreme Court lawyers. So, Mr. Rao, please do not misunderstand me. In my 40 years in the spirits industry, I have dealt with 40 into 32 governments into 12 months, where every year the government's rules and governments change. So I know exactly where the governments, what goes into the government mind and their constituency is from where they get the votes, from where I also get my consumers. So there is no dispute with what you are saying. All I'm trying to say, the liquor delivery system, its time has come. Now, over a period of time, the rules, the laws will have to be evolved. As the gentleman who has been working on the software, Mr. Prasanna, I think we are actually taking every possible outcome into account before even proposing something. So yes, Mr. Rao, without those masses that you are talking about, which the state government purportedly is supposed to be very concerned for whom the 20 lakh crore package has been designed, I am equally concerned because they are my consumers. So let's not get into a personal battle here. That's my request to you.
Prasanna, I want to ask a question. Can excise department be also involved in this home delivery system?
It can't happen without them.
Can we give them the hold of the application so that they can handle? You people can educate them how to handle it, because I have been receiving.
That's what HIBAR has been trying to do. Okay. In fact, the job of HIBAR is to make the excise, even though, see, first is we want to establish the right to do business by within the existing laws that. Mm-hmm. Through the system of agency to buy alcohol, there is no requirement under the law to make it happen. The second is, now that there is a possibility to do it, what are the reasonable restrictions that the government wants to introduce in this activity? So we are approaching it purely from an interplay of technology and law. So we look at the law and then design the systems which will be compatible with the law. And whatever shortfalls are there, we address it through other mechanisms. For example, somebody may say, What happens if I get spurious alcohol? How can you stop it? The right way to stop it is not to go and catch and trace and find out what's going on, but to create a system of feedback, where customers can call up and report suspicious products or do it within the app. So there is an audit trail that is established. People can go and find out. The system, the more it becomes easy for people to report shortcomings in service or reporting suspicious products, the system will automatically improve where, gray channels get eliminated. So on day one, no system will be foolproof. But the good thing about technology is more than anything else, you can, write few lines of code and stop most of the, fait accompli leakages from repeating itself. And the other thing which Mr. Roy rightly said is we need to co-opt the traders, the liquor retailers, because they are having, in certain markets, they bid based on the areas. There is an auction system. So how do you maintain real world integrity also digitally? So these are some of the aspects which HIBAR has been deeply looking at. As somebody who is from the domain, and considering that we have been battling this much before any organization came into jumping on fighting for delivery, HIBAR has been single-handedly and unilaterally trying to make this happen. through various means. And but we have complete alignment with the industry leaders that we don't want to do anything that will upset the 95% of the business, which is through the retail. Yeah. This will have to slowly evolve and start, you know, hopefully adding and supplementing the sales channels and the revenue channels which the government has. So we understand the limitation on day one. So we are evolving the system. We expect that the industry should come together and support the digital initiatives. And obviously, within the four corners of law, we will do it, which will be a win-win for everyone. That is what HIBAR has been trying to do.
I'll go to Nishant now. Nishant has been keeping silent for a long time. What has been said here. Nishant, as Dr. Rao has said, a lot of social issues also important for government.
Dr. Rao has said that
green shoots emerging and things have to change.
Also said,
this is digital is the way forward. How easy or difficult is India, because you deal with the courts also, deal with the government also, how easy or difficult for them to be make certain changes to facilitate this online delivery possible?
Sure, sir. I will begin with the example of Mr. Natarajan, HIBAR.
Please, it's very brief because we are showing for short time.
What had happened in his case in the High Court, one very interesting thing was observed by the Honorable High Court of Karnataka. It's stated that the state excise laws do not have the provisions to permit licensing of alcohol delivery under the Karnataka Excise Act. And this is valid for all the state excise laws. So unless and until we start from there, we amend the laws over there, there is provision for alcohol delivery kind of thing in the excise laws. Because I don't think that we are anywhere lagging in the technological aspect. I give the example of Tata or other service private player, which is handling our passport renewal and issuance thing. If that can be done by a private player, why cannot be this the home delivery of liquor? Then again, we have examples like Paytm and other payment banks where know your customer, they come and verify everything, that what is your age, what is your occupation, where do you stay, whether. And very interestingly, many people criticize this thing, home delivery, that minors will come, make orders. I don't agree at all. Who is going to, which kind of minor he would be to order online delivery of liquor to his place? Instead of, he will go to a theka and give 10 rupees and buy it, ask a rickshaw puller to buy it for him.
Okay, so your point is taken now, Nishant. Now I'll move on to Divya. Because
I was supposed to bring that point.
go ahead.
The same one.
He has already responded.
Okay.
I just want to say that it is not something that's going to start tomorrow. It's an evolution. It's going to take maybe a couple of years. As Mr. Rao said, there are some entitled judges also in Supreme Court who, without any injection from the industry, actually told all the state governments to start examining the home delivery system and online system.
Correct.
So even the judges' mindsets are changing. They are also now more aware.
No, sir. May I interrupt you, sir?
Nishan, we don't have time for that.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll go to Divya now. Okay, Divya. Yeah, sure. This is all happening.
I'm only trying to say that, the one has to take a view. This is perhaps the best time to put full effort from all the stakeholders to change the system. I think the climate is right. The COVID has come as a blessing in disguise for this particular subject. The
home delivery
departments do not wish to lose their revenues, and they have to make sure that we somehow or the other not lose this very important stream of revenues. They are in a mood to listen. The excise departments also realizing that they cannot control the crowds at retail outlets. So everybody is in a mood to find a better method. And what is the what better time to than to for the industry and all the stakeholders to get together and do it? That's the point.
Thank you.
Divya, your final thoughts, please.
I think overall, to summarize what everyone said, it's just going to be a slow process in India, but it's going to take a while, and it's going to take a while for each state to adapt to all these regulations and uplift these policies that have already existed for 70 years. But of course, all in all, it's going to boost up the beverage alcohol industry and the revenue generation for India. And talking about, it's definitely going to cater a diverse consumer market, especially women. I would like to put that forward. That outlook will change. The taboo will gradually perish, hopefully, because more women will start drinking. And about the legal drinking age, as Mr. Nishant rightly said, no underage person below 18 would definitely drink at home. He'll never order alcohol at home. He'd rather go sit somewhere and just pay some money and drink. So that, of course, can also be addressed. And as far as the tech is concerned, we are moving towards a tech-driven world. And this pandemic has taught us that predominantly. So I think it makes sense to create this space in the beverage alcohol industry. It is the time to, you know, like step in at this particular pandemic situation and grow from here. That's what I feel.
Yeah. Mani, you have any final thought? Brief thought from you?
My final thought is get all the stakeholders, and this is not at the expense of the wholesaler or the retailer. They have to be co-opted into the system, and that's how it works. And in all the countries where online has been a success, it's through one of them. It goes from the retailer or from the wholesaler, and mostly from the retailers, I would say.
Dr.
So
Ron?
If that be the case, then it's a win-win and it's a conference.
I can't hear you. Your audio is... Audio is closed.
From what Mr. Ramesh had said, like even the Australian case, there are numerous parameters about supply, and they are all taken into account. There's a history of whether there has been any drunkenness, etc., all of which are cited. Now, the important thing, the key to all of this is technology. What Mr. Prasannan will be the person who can give it, who can create the various parameters. If there has been any case of domestic violence, if there has been a previous case of a minor being delivered alcohol, quantity of it delivered, the localities, the areas, you know, the entire scheme architecture of responsibility has to be brought about by the technology which carries out all the parameters are taken into account in order to ensure that the scheme is successfully
implemented. Nishant?
What is my main thing that I'm trying to say?
Your final thought.
It's more about technology is very much there. It's change of mindset we need to have. And then change of laws, because technology can be brought in within a very short span of time. We have people like HIPAA who have used it, utilized it. But it's all about the laws which needs to change a bit, because whatever Supreme Court has observed in the PIL, it was in the context of in order to avoid crowding at liquor shop amid the coronavirus induced lockdown, the state may consider home delivery of liquor. That is what I'm quoting Supreme Court. So it's not an open invitation. It's just for the temporary phase.
Prasanna?
So it's a matter of time. I think that before the next 2021, most states in India will be online. And it's the need of the hour, and it is the compulsion of time. Both factors have come into play. And I think the India can start a renaissance of its drinking culture through this development of an online channel, which will substitute the trade, which will complement the existing trade structure. And I think we can save one generation from becoming habitual drinkers by introducing digital quota and other things that we can bring in for responsible consumption. And I think every state in its right mind will take up to online, despite the opposition. And the industry has to play the play the soothing factor to bring about this change management.